Welcome to our instructor webinar series. This time we're going to be talking about using Cesim simulations for online and virtual courses. I understand that many instructors have been forced to switch to virtual with a very short notice. I hope that personally you and your families are not heavily influenced by the virus. From Cesim side, we do whatever we can to help you through this challenge, whether you're an existing or a new adopter. My name is Veijo Kyösti. I'm CEO and senior partner at Cesim, and I will be your guide during this presentation. Today we are going to be talking about the format. One of the most important things, as it is in face-to-face learning, but especially in the online learning, is the structure. So I will show you an example format. Then obviously students are interested in the grading and evaluation. So I have an example for that as well. Plus then I will go through the platform features that are especially useful for the online and virtual simulation-based learning. Before we go to my content, I want to point you to another great resource. Here, our partner, Harvard Business Publishing, has put together a site where they have very good materials, and make sure that you do not miss the webinar by Bill Sciano, Adapting Quickly to Teaching Online. He has a lot of experience teaching online, and this webinar is really, really worth your while. Now let's get started with the format as promised. So in this picture we have quite a few different elements. I will explain them to you. So here the assumption is that we run the simulation course sort of as a combination of synchronous and asynchronous learning. So whatever I have indicated here with the red S indicates a synchronous session, and then the rest is asynchronous. And the simulation rounds, they have been usually played with 1 or 2 week intervals. This could be a shorter one as well. So if you need to run the simulation over 3 days or even in 1 day, it is possible, but this is the most typical format that we see. The simulation typically includes practice round and then actual decision making rounds. So the total number of rounds that the students play is, I would say, between 4 and 10. Quite typically, but that's up to you to decide. So the process starts with sharing the materials before the kickoff. So here you see that you can share the case description, decision guide, and the tutorial video beforehand. Plus then you want to have an idea that how the students will be placed in teams. This can be quite important. And now sometimes the students have their own preferences, but especially in the online and virtual format, the recommendation is that you have a very good idea how you want to put the students in teams. And in some cases, it is also possible to have the students do the simulation individually. Many instructors do it that way as well, but it sort of takes away the social learning aspect. So then we come to this first synchronous session where we can do an introduction so that the instructor can still give a little overview of what is happening in the simulation. Then we can still shuffle the teams if needed. So if it turns out that you have less participants than you expected, if you have more participants, then it's possible still to reshuffle the teams. And then depending on the time that you have available, you can also do the practice round. In this session, typically the practice round, depending on the simulation, it takes between 1 and 2 hours. So if you have a virtual conferencing tool available that has breakout rooms, then that's a great way to utilize those breakout rooms. And then you have a brief overview of the results at the end of it. So most of our simulations have a quiz available, which is testing the participant understanding of the simulation rules. So a good place to run the quiz is here after the practice round, because at that point we can also assume that they would have read the manuals. After the quiz, before the first round deadline, many instructors request the teams to put together a strategy plan. So they need to have a bit of an idea of what the team is planning to do and share a vision about how to run their business. Then that's followed by the deadline. So this is the first round deadline here, this thick line. And then after the deadline, then typically there is a synchronous session to discuss about the results. So here you can be creative, you can have the different teams as students from another team, again depending on how big course you have, but make sure that you try to keep this as interactive as possible. And if you don't have much time available, then it's good just to have people together, look at the results, and sort of maintain the momentum and keep everybody focused on the task at hand. I have also added another element here, which is a learning log. So this learning log could be either team-based or individual. The idea with the learning log is anyway to make sure that the either individuals or the teams, they are recording round by round what they did, what went well, what didn't go so well, and how are we going to be improving for the next round. Plus, in these learning logs, you can also tie in some of the lecture topics if you like. So if you, for example, discuss about marketing strategies or 4Ps or whatever is the topic at hand in a lecture, then you can ask the teams or the individuals to apply those lecture notes in that particular learning log for the round. Then we move on again to the second deadline, followed by the results discussion, and this kind of cycle follows around the midway. It could be useful to have a midterm review, almost like a presentation or to the board or to the investors. Again, depending on how big is your course, but it's a good idea to have a sort of check up where the teams are, whether they are on the path that they should be. And towards the end, the teams, and this is typically a team-based, I would say it's exclusively team-based stage here, where they need to write a strategy review. Now in the online environment, it is also very, very good idea, instead of have them write something, they should create a video. So I've seen some wonderful videos, the participants, the students and teams, they can be really creative when they explain the storyline, they can include nice graphics, plus they have more fun when they make a video rather than do writing. So here, high recommendation for the video format strategy review. And there's a possibility to run a peer evaluation in the end. This is a platform feature that you can run. It's a simple peer evaluation where the each individual in a team is just allocating points to the team members. And then in the end, you can have the last synchronous session where you just summarize the lessons learned and reflection. Okay, so now that we have the format in place, we also need to think about the evaluation and grading. And now, again, this is just an example. So we have game results, which I have pulled out from here a little bit, because our recommendation is that the game results should not be too big of a proportion in the overall grade. So here it says 10%, it could be up to 20, but it would be a mistake to make it too high, because if the teams are not doing well in the beginning, they may lose motivation, and that's not what we want to happen. So game results can play a small role. We also have instructors who give no weight for the game results. Then I have added this kind of T, which indicates team, and then I, which indicates individual. So then you can measure the participation. Later when we go to the platform, you can see it. I will show you the logs. You can also have different ways of evaluating the participation during the synchronous sessions and potentially on the discussion forums, but participation should be included. Then there's the learning log slice here. Now I have indicated that as an individual, but it could be team-based as well. Then we have peer evaluation, which is provided by the platform. So just with a click of a button, you can initiate the peer evaluation in the end of the course. And then we have the strategy review, which is team-based. And as mentioned earlier, personally, I would have them do that as a video. And then there's the quiz. And the quiz is also available from the platform itself. Now we will be moving to the platform. Just give me a second. Okay. So now this is what the instructor platform looks like, and the purpose of this session now is not to go through our platform in detail, but I will just show the elements that are particularly useful for the virtual environment. So here we go to the courses page, and we find the schedule link. So on the schedule, we can obviously set the deadlines for each of the rounds, but we can also include some sort of non-game related or non-simulation related deadlines. If we want to keep all the schedule notes in one place, we can also include them here on the simulation schedule. Many of you are using your own LMSs, that's totally fine. You can keep it at the minimum on the simulation side and then have everything on the LMS side, but sometimes there's no LMS available, so then you can use the simulation platform. You can see the simulation logs. You can see how much each participant has been spending. Now I have this demo course here where we don't have extensive time of spent by the participants, but here you can see total time spent and last login time. But more detailed information we get on the metrics page. And here on the metrics page, we also see some financial indicators. Plus then by clicking any of these total time spent links, we can also see the time spent per round. And sometimes it is nice to observe the time spent round by round. So you can see if the engagement is increasing or decreasing, and especially if it's decreasing, if you need to change something in the process. Assigning the quiz happens here. You assign the quiz and then you can pick the quiz that is most appropriate for that simulation. Peer evaluation, again, is started here. And then it's also possible to upload some materials through this platform, but this is typically handled by your own LMSs. Decisions page shows the different team decisions side by side. Plus then here you can also see who has been saving the decisions and when. This also in some cases can indicate the participation by the individuals. So round by round for each team you can see who saved the decisions, who had done the decisions, who had modified the decisions. So this can give a good idea of how the team dynamics work internally. Well, results is results. Case management we don't care about at the moment. On the materials page, we have the option to upload materials. Again, if you don't have a LMS available, then we have this material management section, which allows you to upload and add different materials. You can embed a video or you can upload a file that you want the participants to have available in their interface. Discussion forum. This can be quite useful. And whether you have the discussion happen inside the simulation or on the LMS, that doesn't matter. You do it where you think it's best to do. But now, personally, I see a lot of value in having the teams conduct their conversation. Okay, let me just take another thread here. We can see that, okay, now in the green team, that's one of my teams. I can step into this team area and then I can see that there's a topic, technology development. So the students have been posting some notes about this issue. I can see what they have been conversing and I can comment if I want. So if we can make the participants discuss on this forum, that creates a nice track of the discussion. Plus then another idea is that when possible, then involve the students for the kind of like helping each other. So we can see sometimes really valuable input from the students. When there's a question from somebody, then another student may quickly post an answer to the question, and then if possible you can also use this as part of the participation evaluation. Again, I'm not saying that you should use the simulation forum, but if you are able to have them discuss on some kind of forum, whether it's an LMS or the simulation, then it gives you nice visibility to what they are going through during the decision making rounds. Okay, so next we step into the participant interface and see how that looks like. So again, no discussion about the content itself, but on the home page we have the schedule. Here they can see what are the different schedule notes. We can see the messages and we can see the activity, and now I'm inside the system as a student. So this is how my home page looks like. On the schedule page, now I can see the deadlines that my instructor has set for me. Plus, I can see then the other deadlines, which are the non-game deadlines. Teams are here as well. And the nice thing about the Teams section is that a team name for themselves, they can make a team description if they like. And plus, they can make an introduction, like a team introduction video here. So just copy the embed code here, and then the other teams will be able to see the team. Reading section. Now we have the standard materials, and then for the sake of an example, I have now embedded one piece of material, which is now a video. And then the discussion forums are here. We have the team forum, and then we have the course forum. Now the last thing here, but not definitely not the least, is the decision-making process, because here in our simulations we have one very, very important component, which is the decision checklist. Each participant has their own access to the simulation, and now we have three members in this team. So each team member makes their own decisions and estimations, and then through this decision checklist they can see what each other member have done. And then we can also step into the decision making area of the other person, plus then we copy somebody's decisions and as the team decisions, and then we can together decide which decisions we want to submit as a team. So everybody will be very much hands-on. Plus, it's transparent. Everybody will see what the other team members have done. Okay, so now let's go back to do a little summary. I have collected pointers here. So, as mentioned, everybody has their own access to the simulation. Embrace that and follow the activity through the logs. This is a wonderful opportunity for the students to practice virtual teamwork, which is a very relevant skill in real life. Make sure that the students understand the decision checklist functionality, plus promote the idea that each individual will prepare their decisions before the joint team meeting, because the best outcome will happen when everybody has been thinking about the decisions, and then we get together and decide what is the team decision. More of a general advice, do not feel responsible for analyzing the results on behalf of the students. Make the students work for it. So this is, especially in the asynchronous format, there's plenty of time between the rounds. Let the students analyze, benchmark, and come up with different explanations. They may have questions that they want to ask. If you don't know the answer, then our support will surely be available to help you with all the questions. Then let students help each other if possible, link the activity to grading. And then regarding the lectures and the different content topics, have the students tie those lectures into the simulation performance. This concludes our session about running Cesim simulations for online and virtual courses. Please contact us whenever you need help, either with course planning or course implementation. Our sales team and our support team are available for your questions. Thank you very much, and bye for now.